لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، ما لنا رب سوى.
لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين. أحمدك ربي على كل قضائك وجميع قدرك، حمد الرضا بحكمك لليقين بحكمتك، وأصلي وأسلم على خير خلقك ونور عرشك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على أشرف الخلق وحبيب الحق المصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Brothers and sisters in Islam, respective viewers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and أهلا وسهلا, welcome to our program. Let us begin our program with our dua to Allah تبارك وتعالى. May Allah تبارك وتعالى grant all our beloved مرحومين جنة الفردوس. اللهم اغفر لهم وارحمهم وسكنهم في الجنة. رب ارحمهما كما ربيانا صغيرا. And we ask Allah تبارك وتعالى, may Allah grant those children who are writing the exam, may Allah make it easy for them. May Allah تبارك وتعالى grant them knowledge, and may Allah use them for Deen Islam. Our best dua to our teenagers and our friends in universities, and also writing matrics and all the exams. May Allah تبارك وتعالى reward you for your effort, and may Allah write for you inshallah good taqdeer. On behalf of all my friends here on the studio, we make a special dua for those who are ill. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them. May Allah grant them speed recovery. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us, inshallah. May Allah make it easy for all Muslim ummah and the entire creation of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. You heard me reading so much Surah Al-Asr. And then when we say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wal-Asri, innal insana lafi khusr, إلى الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. صحابة, and when they read this ayat, this conclusion of Islam, if you understand the meaning of this surah, they used to leave each other with this surah, that surah al-Asr. When we talk about Asr, either the world, this dunya, this lifetime, who could be, the commentator said, could be your age, your life. Or it could be the era, which that era you live, or any era you live. Or it could be the time of Asr, that afternoon time. When you read the tafsir of Surah Al-Asr, you feel that is more longer than Surah Al-Baqarah. That they say Asr, it means juicing. Or in the day of Qiyamah, Allah will juice you till we get goodness from you, and the evil also to pay for it in the day of Qiyamah. We've got plenty tafsir and meaning about Surah Al-Asr. Surah Al-Asr, we call it the conclusion of Nasiha. It's enough to work on this surah and to enter Jannatul Firdaus. But the interesting thing, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. So you have to enjoin, you have to share with in the truth. And also you have to share and you have to enjoin the sabr. You have to encourage each other to be patient, because each and every aspect of this life need you to be patient. And patient is not a literally word or easy word to say it. You have to practice it. Anything you have done good needed patient. And anything you abstain, stay away from it, also needed patient. Those people who cannot make salah because they got a lack of patience, and those who do haram, also they got a lack of patience. So sabr and haqq. What is haqq? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us a dua. Allahumma arina al-haqq haqqa warzuqna ittiba'a, wa arina al-batila batila warzuqna ijtinaba. Before, when we talk about the right of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how powerful is the word of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the dua, you have to understand that when he does not talk from his own, there is an inspiration, there is wahyu yuha, there is a revelation come to him. Anyhow, this dua saying, oh Allah, show me the truth as a truth. That is very important, brother and sister in Islam, because the sign of Qiyamah, that the truth will look like falsehood. And the falsehood will look the truth, and that one we call it ifk. You turn the fact of the things from, like the magician on the stage. They turn the piece of cloth to bird, and turn the bird like this. He give illusion. So make sure that you have haqq, or you are on the haqq, you are on the truth, or you have the fact. Nabi Muhammad ﷺ, he said, لِكُلِّ حَقٍ حَقِيقًا. For every truth or every reality, there is fact. There is a proof and evidence. Brother and sister in Islam, are you on the haqq? Never mind, is haqq small or big, or the truth, or that fact, or that reality is small or big. Do you have that sense of the truth? Because it's very complicated now. People are lying to us, and we trust them, we believe them. And people are cheating, and people, the media and that propaganda against Islam, they describe us now as a terrorist. That one picture turned the entire aspect of Muslims against the reality. People are talking about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such way that he's a terrorist. So, brother and sister in Islam, I want to tell you, do you have that sense to know the truth and fact and reality or not? That's why Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught me and you, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa, oh Allah, show me the truth, or the reality is reality. Okay, you knew the truth. You know the truth. Right, it's not the end of the story. وَارْزُقْنَا اتِّبَاعَ. And grant me, provide me to follow it. How many people like me and you, we know that one is good? Oh, that fact is the truth, is the haqq. But how many of us follow that haqq? And how many of us practice that haqq? How many mothers know that this son was right and his brother is wrong, but because of so many excuses which is not accepted in Islam, and she can't talk? How many people carry the will is haqq, the truth, and they don't want to give, don't want to talk about it? How many people, they are a truthful witness, but they suppress that witness, they don't want to give that testimony and witness? So I just want to tell you, if you are unable to see the truth as a truth, make this dua, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa, and not only that, warzuqna ittiba'a. And in the end of the dua, wa arina al-batila batila, show us the falsehood as a falsehood. Because many people see the falsehood as a truth, or the truth as a falsehood. And then we know that it's falsehood, but وَرْزُقْنَا اجْتِنَابَهُ, and provide us, grant us how to abstain from it, how to stay from it. All of us, we know that lies is falsehood, is not halal, is not allowed. But how many people stay away from it? Many women knows that the haqq is the hijab. This to cover the head is the haqq, is the absolute truth. She believes in it. But where is the action? Where is the practicality of that? Brother and sister in Islam, let's learn that one, how to see the haqq. If you're unable to recognize the haqq, ask the people, let us share the haqq and the sabr. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق. Let us share that advice, how to remind the people of the truth, and Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم encouraging the ummah to speak the truth. They say Muslim got a long tongue, Muslim, they like to offend people. Muslim like, no. We do have command of Allah to give the proper witness, the true witness. If someone call you for something, you have to tell the truth. Al-Haqq, that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, his name is Al-Haqq. Allah Tabarak. And how many people play with this word Haqq? Is my right? If you have two people have got a dispute and fight, everyone believe that he's right. How many haq we have? If you have the haq, what about the opposite person? What haq? What right? What right? What fact? Because we have only one copy of right. We don't have two. So you can't get two people are fighting for two haq. We don't have two haq. We have one haq. Another thing, haq, it means something doesn't change. Can't make it haq today and tomorrow you make it falsehood and after tomorrow you make haq, the truth again, fact. Fact is fact. Allah's name is al-haq. It means never change. Another thing, sometimes the haq disappear. People just hide it somewhere, but it will come. Jaa al-haq wa dhahaq al-batil. The truth will appear and the falsehood will go. Why? Because this is the sunnah of Allah, the system of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, indeed you are the haq and your deen is haq. Oh Allah, show us the haq and bring the haq amongst the people inshallah. Brother and sister Islam, we'll go for a short break. We'll continue after the break inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brother and sister in Islam. And once again, we thank you for your emails, SMSs, and phone calls. I'd like to thank all my viewers from Lodium, yeah, and Pretoria. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, may Allah reward you for your comment. And shukran jazeelan, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make it easy for us to show the truth and the haqq of Allah to ourselves and to the ummah, inshallah. Again, when we talk about the haqq, either it could be the fact, the truth, the reality, or the rights of the others. They call it haq as well. So, how many people did play game with this word? It's called haq. They play with us or they play against us with this haq. And sometimes people use haq to get batil. The Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, haqqun yuradu bihi batil. Sometimes you speak the truth to get the falsehood. We find that one in some of the media, some of the books, some of the people who changed the falsehood to the lovely name. They call it freedom, civilization, they call it civilization. They call it new knowledge, technology, way of life. They name it in a very gentle way so that they must cover it and deceive us and try to deviate from the haq. Haq is the truth with a proof. That's called haq. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard one man said, "Asbahtu billahi mu'minan haqqa." Today I believe in Allah in reality. I mean, truly believe in Allah. So Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never allow him to say like this. Say, wait. لكل حق حقيقة. For every truth there is fact and reality. ما حقيقة إيمانك? What is the proof and reality of your iman? He said, "O Messenger of Allah, I can see the people of Jannah in Jannah, and I can see the people of hellfire on hellfire, and I renounce this world till the gold and dust are equal in my eyes." Nabi Muhammad said to him, "Arafta falzam." Yes, this is a bottom line of iman. This is the top of iman. The other thing we have, ulaika humul mu'minuna haqqa. Indeed, those who are truly believer, the absolute believer. If we say ulaika humul mu'minuna haqqa, it means you got the top believer and then little bit 70%, 60%, and we got halfway haq or the reality there. And we have something, it's called ulaika humul kafiruna haqqa. Indeed, they are the absolute kufar, disbeliever. You got degrees there for the disbelief. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named the zakat, when you pay charity, as a haq. So when the person collects zakat, he deserves to have zakat, he mustn't feel shy because it's your right. Why you look down? It is a payment from Allah. When you get your salary, you don't look down, you work for it. So Allah gave you that charity or that zakat or that help. Take it, it's your haq, it's the haq of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. As I said, Allah is a haq. Quran is haq. Islam is haq. And the promise of Allah is haq. When Allah promises you something, it's the absolute truth. Inna Allah wa'adakum wa'ad al-haq. The shaitan will say that in the day of Qiyam. Allah promised you the absolute promise. You know why? Because no one will break his promise. Why we break our promise? Because we change our mind. Someone got power above us and he stopped us. Maybe we don't have that reason and means for that. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala encouraged me and you to always talk about the haqq. Islam is haqq. Lahu da'watul haqq. For Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, for him is the absolute call. When we see Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar for salah. As I said before, the truth is haqq. وَقُلُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُ وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُ. Speak the truth and speak about Allah, the truth. Jahannam, hellfire is haqq. Many people when they read إِنَّكَ لَا تُخْلِفُ الْمِعَادِ, they say, oh indeed Allah promised us Jannah, but wait, wait, wait. Yes, it's true that he promised us Jannah, but he promised us also something else. There is punishment. So you can, you got Naeem, bounty of Allah, you got Jannah, and you got some next door. Next door is Jahannam. So why you, إِنَّكَ لَا تُخْلِفُ الْمِعَادِ. Okay, he promised the liar to enter Jahannam. He promised the hypocrisy will enter Jahannam. So we must be worried also about that word is called, you got the ayah here, أَفَمَنْ حَقَّتْ عَلَيْهِ كَلِمَةُ الْعَذَابِ. Allah promised some people that the fact, the haqq, the reality of Jahannam is real. It's not only a frightened word, oh, Allah terrorizing will leave you, can turn serious. Someone said, I will kill you. Maybe he's frightening me. Or no, he will kill you. Sometimes people kill. Another thing also, وَمَا خَلَقْنَاهُمَا إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Allah created the sky and earth with the truth and the fact. When Allah mentioned sky and earth, they call it the dharf and the madhruf. What do you call the container? So the container, when Allah spoke about heaven and earth, sky and earth, sky and earth, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا يُوَا بَيْنَهُمَا. So when Allah said, this is mine, the sky and earth is mine. لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. So obviously what is inside the container is his. So when we say this is my house, I can't ask you, even the window is yours. So I say, Sheikh, this is my house. Or even that chair is yours, that door is yours, that fridge is, the container is mine. So this one, if you are in the airport and then someone put drugs in your bag, you will take that case. You say, I never see, this is your bag. What you got it inside is yours. So brother, sister, Islam, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is haqq, and he encouraged me and you to have that haqq. When we talk about this haqq, we run for the, do you know the right of the others? When we say the right of the others, it means before you claim your haqq, your right, you must know the right of the other. That is our problem with our wives, men and women, employee and employer, neighbors, everyone looking for his right, but they don't know the right of the others. I got here in front of me, Islam fixed that system, how to know that you are right and the opposite person is wrong if you don't know the Sunnah and the Sharia. Men and women are fighting because they are ignorant. They don't know what she's supposed to do for the husband, what the husband's supposed to do for her. So everyone just want to fight with the others. But let me begin with one right which is very, very important. And I got it before I come to the studio. Someone was phoning and asking, what is the right of, I don't know, you people call it those who got speciality. They call it, what you call that word, disabled people. But they say you mustn't say disabled because we disabled to understand them. So Islam choose also a very lovely words for disability. We call him du'afa. Those who du'afa are powerless. Powerless, it means they need a special assist, a special help. And the people call it those who got speciality. Anyhow, all of us, we are powerless. All of us. Powerless to enter Jannah. Powerless to please Allah. Powerless to know our right and the right of the others. Islam never stressed so much on that type of people, because once you know the right of these people, and the people do know their right, is khalas, it's not a main issue. Like color. In Islam, you never heard what black, what. Only Bilal radiallahu anhu, because he was a muadhin of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but you got thousands of sahaba and tabi'een and ulama, they were all black and red and whatever color. Islam never talk about the color, because it doesn't make different the color. Anyhow, that this equality also in Islam is not a main issue, because we deal with him as a normal. Any one of us can be powerless. I mean, disabled. I don't know, they ask us, you mustn't say disabled, but I don't know, it's, we call him the person who gets special need. All of us, we needy. Antumul fuqara ilallah. Right. Anyone can go out from his house, may Allah secure us and save you, come out powerless, spiritually, psychologically, or physically, anyhow. You got about 2,000 reasons to lose your life a day, even if you are healthy. You can die by anyhow. We're dying every day. You can sleep one night, you don't wake up. That's why we said, never sleep on fight. Never, ever dispute and then you close it. Husband and wife, blah, 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 we fight, and then you sleep. Never. You're going to be resurrected on this way, that condition of fight. Sleep on wudu, make dua, close your eyes, make dua and kalima, and you sleep. Inshallah, if you die, you will read the last word you said. But people nowadays, they sleep while the TV is on with the music and fighting and swearing. No, watching a haram thing. What about if you don't wake up? What will happen? You will be resurrected on the day of Qiyamah at the condition you were dying on it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that deenul Islam, to practice it and to die with it, inshallah. They ask me to stop for a short break. We'll continue after the break, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome back, brother and sister in Islam. And once again, we thank you that you're tuning to our program on behalf of all our friends here on Johannesburg studio, Brother Farhad Omar and Brother Mahmoud and Imtiaz and Dr. Muhammad Adam and Dr. Ahmad Adam and all our friends here, those who are taking care of the ITV. We say shukran jazilan that you're tuning to our program, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to pass the fact and the haq of Deenul Islam, inshallah. Before the break, I was talking about the right of our disabled people, which is, I like to mention it, because we got so many rights for the others, but these people, Quran and Sunnah describe them as ajaiz, that they're powerless. It means can get his power. If the petrol is low, you can recharge it and get it. So we call it ajaiz, it means can have that strings later on. We got ulama, the way on that type, they give deen and research. They made effort in this dunya. It's amazing effort. But you read about their personal life, you find them disabled. Like this ajaiz, or there's powerless people. And when I give you the name, you get shocked. For real, you say, yes, it's like that. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took one sense, take one part of his body, but he gave him the barakah on the entire body. You'll see. That's why we said, be careful of the hiding of the blind. Hey, when the blind man, I had a teacher who was a blind, it's a big problem. Because blind, when he hit, you don't know how far is the distance. So now, we said, be careful, because Allah never make him powerless in one, but he give that power to somewhere else. Reciter of the Quran, memorizer of the Quran, that those who make tafsir, I have one friend here in Johannesburg, he's a blind. But what a powerful person, he fixed my computer. Wallahi, he fixed my computer. I don't know how. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the talent and the skill on that. Another thing, anyone who accept that his speciality, he's not disabled. He doesn't, because he accept it. If the blind man agree that he's a blind, he will go home walking, because he will accept the assessing of the people, and then he will get many eyes to take him to home. They will hold his hand. But what about if the blind person refuse to agree that he's a blind, and then he walk on the street and the car knock him? Said, accept that you have speciality, and then you will use. So if someone said, I'm a blind, read for me. Or you say, no, I can read. So you become arrogant and stubborn and don't want to listen. And then anyone who got that speciality and accept it, you'll become very special. You got someone who maybe is a little bit short, or someone who got a certain physical appearance on certain way, you accept it, you become very special, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will bless him and give him the reward of that. These people, when you have that disabled people and all that, not everyone disabled is sick. No. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala didn't call him as a sick. Because what about the one who disabled to believe in Allah? Can we count him sick? فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no, the eyes doesn't have blindness. No, the القلوب التي في الصدور. Only, ولكن تعم القلوب التي في الصدور. Only the hearts and mind getting blind. How many people got eyes, but they don't memorize Quran Kareem? And this boy who just has no eyes, and he memorized the Quran faster than those who got. And then Islam taught us how to deal with these people as a normal people. Yes, as a normal. Yeah. Look at the beauty of him and try to invest on him. The other thing, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he planted and he inspired the Sahaba, those who rules the Khalifa. First thing, they take care on society, take care on these people here, these disabled people. Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, in his lifetime, in his Khilafat, he registered all of them in the entire Muslim world. Before United Nations and this, all that organization who look after these people or disabled, you know, 1,400 years ago, this man, his name is Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the grandson of Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was ruling the Muslim countries and he registered all of them and he knows where they live in the entire Muslim states. Imam Abu Hanifa spoke about these people. He said, you have to assess them, and he got full right to take from Baytul Mal Bighayri Hisab. He can go and take because enough what he got. Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, I admire him. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala reward him. That he gave every blind person a helper. And then helper in the house and one helper to take him somewhere. It means he got two servants. Who's paying that one? Baytul Mal, the department, not the person. The other thing, when we see the people get pension or get some grant from the government, we say, mashallah, we say, no, it was in Islam before. 88 years hijrah time, after hijrah to Nabi, 88 years after hijrah, the Sahaba built the first hospital, take care and look after the mental disability, or they call it mental hospital. 1,400 years ago. They keep these people here, they give them a full care. Al-Khalifa al-Ma'mun, one Khalifa of Islam, he built a special home for the blind people and he made schools for mentally disabled people. School, not hospital, they must learn. Before what we see now, when was that? Long time, thousands of years ago. We have the disability is not only blind. Sayyidina Imam al-Tirmidhi, he had a speciality on his legs. They were stick together. Sayyidina Rabd bin Amir, he was lemming. He got one leg and he was the ambassador of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the leader of Persia. He was ambassador. We have no problem with that at all. As I told you, they treat them normally. Sayyidina Abdurrahman bin Auf, he had a lisp in his tongue, but what a successful businessman in the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Actually, was candidate to be Khalifa after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Uthman bin Maz'un, the first man who died Muslim and buried in Medina, he had one eye. You never heard about that because we don't mention that. It's just a person like that. Qalun, Shaykh al-Qurra, the one who gave us that methodology of qiraat. He was a deaf. But he knows how to read Quran. Sayyidina Musa ibn Nusayr, the opener of Spain, he was lemming, one leg. He's a lemming. Abdurrahman ibn Maktoum, that Surah to Abasa wa Tawalla and Jahul A'ma, he was a blind and he was carrying the flag on one petal, and Nabi Muhammad appointed him as an Amir of Medina in a time of war. He was a ruler, governor of Medina to Munawwar. Sayyidina Mu'adh bin Jabal was lemming like this. He pulled on one leg. Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mas'ud, he was the short man. He was four handspan size, very slim and handspan size. The man of Hadith, Sayyidina Abdullah bin Mas'ud. You heard about Sayyidina? Yes, this one here. Very short. But we don't say short or long. We talk about his iman and his taqwa. Many of the ulama, I give you another thing. Imam al-Razi, he was talking about the disability. He wrote books about the disability in Islam and the treatment, how these people can survive. Ibn Sina, he was the medical man. Ibn Sina was a great scholar, scientist in Islam. He gave us the explanation why the people got deaf, why they are deaf. And then Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he did mention that the powerless person, or the weak person, the one who is unable to get Islam and die with Islam, because this ability of sinning, this ability to come to the road of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Many people, they know the truth, but they are disabled. Many of us, we are disabled to make Salatul Fajr. The water is just next to you. The musalla is next to you. Masjid is very close. You have a shower in your room. Water is there. And you are weak to wake up for Fajr to read Salah or to speak the truth. So who's a blind? Who's a deaf? Who's disabled? Who's unable to walk to the masjid? Definitely this is a real disabled. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, oh Allah, make it easy for us to practice Deenul Islam. And ya Allah, don't let us be disabled to fulfill your right, inshallah. Short break, we'll continue after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brother and sister in Islam. And once again, we say shukran for your emails and SMSs. And on behalf of my sound engineer and brother Yusuf there behind the camera, we say shukran jazilan. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, may Allah make it easy for us to show the road to ourselves and the people, inshallah. Brother and sister in Islam, before the break, and I was mentioning the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a dua, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa warzuqna attiba'a wa arina al-batila batila warzuqna ijtinaba. What a powerful hadith. If you really believe on this dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show you the truth as a truth, and He will make it easy for you to practice it and to follow it. And He will show you the falsehood as a falsehood, and He will let you stay away from it and avoid it, inshallah. As we said, write that the word of Allah is called haqq, very important, and you must know the haqq of the others before you claim your haqq or you assume your haqq. Before the break, I was talking about the right of the disabled people. Oh, how can we deal with these people? The other thing, another powerless people, or the powerless creation of Allah, the animal. When we talk about the animal, I know you see the lion, we get scared, and elephant. No. This one, insan is the khalifa of Allah. Insan has authority on this creation of Allah. You have animal in your life, those who keep the cat or dogs or some birds in the house. You must understand that we're going to be questionable about our children and ourselves. What about this other creation of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala? Feed the animal sufficient food and healthy food and right food. Otherwise, don't keep this animal by your place. Or you let it go to be ha'imah. You must understand that the sickness of the animals is responsibility on us. You have to take care of the sick animals. That shepherd, ask the shepherd how he deal with the sick sheep, and is responsible in the eyes of Allah to put the sick sheep under the shade and water and food and all that. Another thing, animals, you got two types of animals. Animals halal and animals haram. The haram animals doesn't mean that out of the list of mercy of you. So when you slaughter the animal, you need the meat of the animal. So you slaughter it on husna. When you kill the animal which is not halal, also you have to kill in the beauty, not any animals. Not any animals you kill, and we did talk about that in the other program. Another thing also, you mustn't give overload on the animals. Like you mustn't put something, can't take it. How come five people jump on a small donkey? Or how come you let the dog run but the dog can't run? Or anything. The lies on the animals is very big sin. You can't lie on the animals. Nabi Muhammad said, torturing the animals. You're not allowed to torture. You want to kill that mouse, kill it, because you between you and him is just to end his life. But not to torture the body of the animals after that or before. The other thing, Nabi Muhammad, he said, Mal'un man ta'allama ar-rimayata fi hayyin. Curse of Allah for those who learn hunting on a living being. If you want to, you got a gun, you want to learn how to shoot, you can't use it for live animals. No, when you hunt to eat, not to learn how to shoot like this. You must make some other thing. That we call them disabled, because once you look up the cat in your house, which power? Exactly, is a disabled creation of Allah. Another thing also, the haq of the workers. Those people work under you, it's from Allah. But we don't say under you, we say working with you. I know his business is yours, the company is yours, but without them you are nothing. And as we always say, that technician or electrician in the hospital is more important than the minister of health. I know you're going to fight, but it's like that. If the minister doesn't go to his office today, the hospital will run. No patient will die. But if that technician or that person who deal with the machine in the hospital doesn't go, what will happen? What will happen? The patient will die. So there's nothing. It's called a small job and big. All of us, we are part of that system to uplift the community, to serve, to make khidmat to deen. And Nabi Muhammad ﷺ gave so many hadith regarding those who work below us, and you must give him his wages before his sweat get dry. Reason? To forget his pain. When you see the cash like this, oh khalas, look at the mechanic or look at the farmer when he's in a very terrible condition, a lot of mud, but you just pay him, he smile, proudly go home with the overall, with that dirty clothes, and very happy because he got that wages. So Nabi Muhammad ﷺ said, give him his payment before his sweat get dry. Another thing, don't give him job, he can't do it. They call it tuhammilhu ma la yutiq. You can't give him something, he can't take it. I can work this one. Why you want one boy to offload the truck of bricks? The machine take 1 hour to offload it. And you say, no, we agree. You can't. Unless you must put hand to hand, you must assist him yourself. And then give him his wages which you agree about it. Don't try to get excuse. I know my workers, some workers, they like to mess around, but I'm telling you, the al-mu'minuna 'inda 'uqudihim wa 'uhudihim. The believer must fulfill the contract and the aqd. And then you have to feed him. Don't count it that you work with lunch or without lunch. No, that food is something else. And you assess them. Another thing, our children, also powerless. That child is depend on you. So how come you try to torture the child because you're feeding him? We got so many parents say, I feed you, I buy for you clothes. They say, of course, uncle, is the animal do that? You know the lion do that? The cat do that? Is not non-Muslim be doing that? So you see, you must appreciate my son, I do this, I do that for you. Obviously, his parents must do that. I don't know why our parents, they want to kill us by this. And then, the right of the children, you must teach him Deen al-Islam. You must teach him the belief. The best right, you give it to your children. You mustn't let your children go astray. Watch your children, monitor them and see what your children do in the room, and those who got cell phone and all that. Teach the children the love of Allah before the fear of Allah. We don't want to teach our children hypocrisy with Allah. الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. No, I need someone love Allah and obey Allah through this love and fear of Allah. تبارك وتعالى. Let the children love Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, practical love, not literally love. Practice. He must set and proudly practicing the sunnah to Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Teach our children something called moderation. What moderation? You can't stress on the children so much, or you can leave them loose like this. Give him the, try to adjust them. Entertainment got certain level, deen is certain level, and life is certain level. Teach your children occupation. Let your child do something by his. I see some mothers, they don't allow the daughter to go to the kitchen. Say, no, you're going to mess. Let that girl mess to learn. Allah will accept that as a ibadah for you, and I will make dua for you when you teach your daughter something. Teach your children must not be arrogant and had a pride, because we inherit that from our parents. Teach the children, all of us, we are equal. What a lovely children when they pick up from the parents like that. Let them sit with the people and mustn't feel that he's superior. Let the children understand that we live here to please Allah, and if you kill yourself or you neglect your right and you kill yourself and you harm yourself, you die with me because of that you are careless, Allah will punish you. Now, inshallah, we'll make a special program about why our teenagers, the young boys and girls, thinking to end their life. You must teach the children that is not a decision, my son. This one year, you're running from small problem to the bigger problem. Killing yourself is a major sin in Islam. خَالِدًا مُخَلَّدًا فِيهَا. You will remain on the fire of Jahannam ever and ever and ever. But parents will pay why the child reached that level of thinking. It's definitely, there is a big pressure on the child. No one listened to him, or this child keeps some secret in his heart. Another thing which is very important also, teach the children, life is not a materialistic thing. I know we need it, but contentment, alhamdulillah, the words called alhamdulillah must be in reality in our life. You must bring it in action, alhamdulillah. Look at the people below you, and even if you are the lowest, you must think that you are rich, rich by iman, rich by la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, rich that you are accepted by Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Because some people, they sell their deen, religion, to get dunya. And then when they die, he lost dunya, lost his religion. That's why we teach the children must have contentment, must appreciate, must be happy with Allah and his parents, and he must wait for the good news, inshallah, will come in the future. You're still young. There's a lot of hope that you will come right, inshallah. Unfortunately, my time is up. Inshallah, we'll continue for more. Shukran jazeelan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله ما لنا رب سواه.